Hey guys, I'm Shreeman. I didn't know it was gonna be, but there was a probability that was gonna be. So today's topic is some probability. Let's think of an interesting scenario to get you hooked in, okay? Imagine in your dream or real life you are entering like some fighting competition. You have to fight someone. But there's only one rule. At any given round, you can only punch or kick that person, okay? And of course, you know the consequence of it is that if you hit someone in the nose or hit someone in the face, maybe they start bleeding.
Oh no!
Okay? Take note of these things as I go through this video, okay? So on probability, right, you're probably wondering, how in the world do you approach this topic? And a lot of you guys think this topic is hard. Yes, it's hard. So I'm gonna give you an approach for this. Since it's hard, leave it to the end. Okay, if you're going to leave this to the end, what topic should I do first? How do I prioritize my exam time for math? So all these questions are highlighted in that video up there in the link, as well as in the description. A really great video on managing time for A-level math. But I don't want to go too deep into those kind of things.
Nope.
Because it's videos about probability. Leaving it to the end, don't do these types of questions first, because it's very easy to lose marks, okay? The approach I'll give you next is if they give you two types of questions. One is scenario based, like the one I told you guys, okay, the one on the fighting competition. So the scenario based question, or they give you like weird sets and weird things, or some weird variables like A prime union B, A intersect B, intersect C, and this kind of like so many of these things that actually make you confused. The general approach I have, right, is two ways you can tackle this. Number one, using a probability tree, correct? You've probably heard of this branching out tree in your A-level math syllabus. Not only probability tree, you can also use a Venn diagram. Okay? Which one should you use? I'll talk about it in later part of the video. But the general thing I can give you is, for scenario-based questions, right? I told you about the punch, I told you about the kick, I told you about the bleeding. I genuinely recommend to use something very important, use variables. So for example, punch. Let's use the first letter, punch. Then K is what? K. B is for bleed. And why am I doing this? Because in a probability tree, right, if you were to branch it out, it will contain B, and then it will contain B prime. So it'll be like B primes intersect this, there'll be this kind of variables coming in. It's very easy if you use letters instead of writing long-ass statements. So how does a probability tree look like? A probability tree, all it does, right, is this represents a statement. What do I mean by that, okay? So you have a statement, right? This guy got kicked and that guy started bleeding. So let's start from the center. Using the same variables that I told you, this guy gets punched or kicked. And see the probabilities that are given in the question is 0.3 and 0.7 probability, okay? Now, this thing branches in further, the guy bleeds and does not bleed. For does not bleed, we want to put an apostrophe sign to indicate the complement of this, okay? So, this one, when you kick, you also bleed. So how do you represent it as a statement? Where do you see the statement? This guy was punched and then he bleeds. This guy was punched and did not bleed. So the question they ask you, what is the probability that the guy gets punched and does not bleed? You see yourself tracing along the tree, right? Tracing. This is such an important concept. This is so special about the tree, okay? Now if you guys noticed something really interesting,
nope.
Those along one branch, right? Like this, okay? All of these individual sections, they add up to one, and they must add up to one. If it exceeds one, you overcount it. If it's under one, maybe did not consider some new possibilities. So do take note of that. Remember I told you about you can only do one punch or one kick. You can't do a punch and a kick at the same time. So what am I saying? And do you find this familiar? This is what is the definition of mutually exclusive events. So if you were to draw a Venn diagram, right? If you were to look at this Venn diagram, I'm sure you put some weird sign right here. Since you can't do both at the same time, this thing, P intersect K, correct? The probability of it is zero. Because this intersect thing, right? This intersect basically means the word end. Do note this point. Intersect means end. So if you look at a Venn diagram, P, right? Let's represent P like that and K like that. Okay? These two things cannot intersect at any given time because they can't occur simultaneously. That's why P intersect K, the probability of it, is zero. And a really important point I'd like to highlight actually came out in one of the A-level questions. You don't need to draw circles in a Venn diagram. You can jolly well just draw some weird shape, for example, a triangle cutting across, and say this is P and that is K. Wow. It's okay. So when you're talking about either or but not both, which means that P and K are mutually exclusive events, what can you do? So you need to find the probability of P or K. What is the probability of P or K? Probability that it punches or kicks. When you see the word or, okay, the word you should think of, the mathematical operation you should think of is add. Okay, this one was and, this one is add. So you can add the probability of finding P, that it punches and it kicks. In this case, it's 0.3 plus 0.7, which is 1. Okay? Okay, now let's proceed to independent events. The general principle I would really, really want to emphasize, right? Independent events usually hold when you're considering chain or some kind of consecutive events that are occurring. What do I mean by that? Imagine this scenario. You have a pocket, it's filled with some blue balls, and you also have some orange balls. Now let's say in the first round, you pick blue ball. And the second one, a big blue ball. Okay? But the notable difference is that in the first round, pick a blue ball, what's the probability? Half. Because half of the bag is filled with blue balls. But after you pick the first ball, they say, put it back in. You don't take it with yourself and sell it to someone else.
Bruh.
So once you put it back in, the second round, when you find the probability of finding the blue ball, is it the same as half or different? It is the same. So that means that the event, this event, and this event, correct, are independent of each other. Which means, so the thing is, the first round you pick a blue ball, second round you pick a blue ball, both have the same probability. So talking back about this punch and this kick thing, in the say in the first round, you punch that person, okay? In the second round, you're like kicking the person. Okay? Just because you punched in the first round, you're like punch, and then you're like, oh man, I feel bad, I should not have done that. And the next round, you kick. That's when these two events, the first and the second one, are not independent. Because there is, what do you call it? This is your hashtag, biasness. When there's biasness, events 1 and 2, the probabilities change. Because you're like, oh, I punched this person, maybe the next round I want to kick. So the probability of you kicking in the second round is no longer 0.7, maybe it's like 0.8. Correct? So that's not independent events. Now the likely question you're asking is, are this P and this K independent events? Are they? Honestly, I won't answer this question. Because it's totally a waste. Because they said already in the question, either P or K happens at any given time. So how can P influence K? Because only one occurs at a certain time, how can a punch influence the kick? They can't. Like, you're not able to do it at the same time, correct? Unless you're doing a chain. Like, first round you do this, second round you do this, then it makes sense. So it's not worth considering whether P and K are independent events, okay? Please don't get confused about this. now, coming back to this probability tree, I digress a bit more into the theoretical work. Let's get a bit more fun. Now, let's see the question they give you. These values, okay? They say this value is 0.4, 0.6, 0.4, 0.6. The question I want to ask you, right? I want you guys to think, what does this 0.4 and 0.6 represent? What does this represent? It's conditional probability. What do I mean by that? Do not panic, and do not panic. I'll just represent it as a statement, okay? So, the probability that the person bleeds if he gets punched. What does that mean? If he gets punched. So, like, conditional probability, right? They will give you either if or given that. Like, they may state it. So you know that given that he has been punched, the probability that he bleeds is 0.4. Because if you were to blatantly ask, what's the probability that that guy bleeds? It not only include this, but also this. There's an important distinction between probability that he bleeds versus probability that bleeds given that he has been punched. That is, given that or if is represented by this line. So then what does this 0.6 represent right here? Probability of B prime given P has occurred. Because what it blatantly see, what's the probability that it did not bleed? It will include this and this. So you get really confused, okay? I want to point you guys to a difference between conditional, okay, conditional versus intersection. If it's a conditional probability, you can start in the middle. So you're like, hey, let me start at a punch and then go to here. This statement goes here to B, probability of it is 0.4. You can start in the middle because you're already given something. You're like, given that punch has already occurred. But if it's an intersection sign, you must and must always start from the start. So what do I mean by start from the start? Okay, let's calculate this out, which will actually help you. Probability of B. Probability that this guy bleeds. What is it? It's the sum of the probability that he gets punched and then he bleeds. Okay, punched and bleeds. Plus, okay, because or, right? Can you either get punched or kicked? So when you see the or, you add. So probability that gets kicked and then he bleeds. Now, what do you put right here? You put the intersection sign because you're starting from the start. You start from the start, you say this intersect this. But if you start from the middle of a branch, right? If you're starting from here, this 0.4 would represent probability of B given P. But this 0.3 times 0.4 gives you the probability of P intersect B. Okay, so get this small difference between these two things. So when you get P intersect B, when you see the intersect, what did I say? Use the multiplication sign. So you just multiply it out, 0.3 times 0.4 plus 0.7 times 0.4. Got it? So that's it, guys. That's the main essence of what I want to cover about probability. And if this video helped you, to share it with your friends, to subscribe to my channel, and stay tuned for my next episode of Revision with KJ Shreeman. Bye!